Hello, amazing students. Welcome to interviews part six. So there's a few more questions that they're going to ask you on an interview. Always need to be prepared for them. The next one they're going to ask is, tell me about yourself. This is the perfect opportunity to sell yourself to an employer in just a few seconds. Essentially, you need to package yourself, or as the buzzword is now, you need to brand yourself, okay? You're going to package yourself into one small paragraph, a short paragraph, where you mention your experience, your skills, accomplishments, goals, and personal qualities. Short and sweet, with all of those juicy things packed right in. When they ask this and you are not prepared, then this is what ends up happening. Tell me about yourself. I'm in sports. Yeah. See how that didn't work so well? Okay. You are going to be ready. If anything, that is something you might want to memorize. The next question they will ask is, tell me about a situation that frustrated you at work or at school. This is a trick question. The question is designed to probe your professionalism, to see if you talk smack, to see if you talk poorly about people, if you put them down, if you're a whiner, if you're a complainer, because nobody likes that. The interviewer also wants reassurance from you that you are able to withstand pressure on the job. So in the back of your head, because you're going to be ready for this question, you're going to find a situation that frustrated you at work or at school. And it could be with a teacher, a student, a coach, a counselor, a principal, anything that you want. But you're not going to put them down. You're going to be diplomatic, objective, and professional. And you're going to show how you remain so in that difficult situation, how you acted correctly. Now is not the time to say, my teacher hates me. She didn't understand that everybody died in my family and I can't get my work done. Okay, that's not working. You will not get the job. You will not get into the college you want. You would say essentially something, let's say that difficult situation was you had a lot of things come up and you couldn't get your work done for 2 months. You're going to have to explain why, one, you learned something from the situation. One, that teachers and employers have expectations, not for themselves, but for the betterment of the student. You did not meet those expectations because you didn't turn in any of your work for 2 months because of issues, whatever those issues may be, and you learned a valuable lesson. See, whenever you mess up, you're going to say that you learned a valuable lesson, that despite the whole world collapsing around you, that people's expectations don't necessarily change and that you still have to perform the functions. Was that frustrating? Yes, but you learned a valuable life skill. See how I turned that around? Another question they might ask you is, have you ever had to work with a manager who you thought was unfair, or a teacher or a coach who was unfair to you, or who was just plain difficult to get along with? Don't fall for this either. It is another trick. It is another track. Another question they will ask you is, have you ever had to work with a manager or a teacher or coach who you thought was unfair to you, or who was just plain difficult to get along with? Don't fall for this either. It's another trick. See, they ask a lot of tricky questions. No matter how many times an employer gives you the opportunity to berate, belittle, criticize, talk negatively about someone, you will never, ever do it. Why? Because I've got news for you. You're going to work with lots of crappy people, lots of crappy students, lots of crappy professional people and business people. That's the way of the world. Welcome to Adulting 101. If you don't believe me, just ask your parents. I'm sure they have lots of stories. The employer is trying to discover how easily you will badmouth people, and nobody wants somebody who badmouths other people. So you are always going to take whatever situation that was and show how you learned from it, how you personally learned about working with a difficult person. What did you learn from it? Now, go back and take a look at your DISC test. As you notice, there's those four different working personalities. You can go back and look at your Myers-Briggs. You would see how I would have a difficult time working with someone who was like, yeah, whatever, like, I really don't care what I do, like, it's whatever. You would see how that would aggravate somebody like me, who was major D for dominant and who was an INTJ, right? So am I going to put down all those other worker types? No, I'm going to show what I learned from them, okay? And that's what you're going to do. Another question they might ask it. What are some of the things your supervisor has done that you dislike? Your supervisor, a teacher, a counselor, whatever. Anybody that is, you know, not another, even a student. They could even say, oh, you know, what are some of the things that a student has done that you didn't, anybody that you just, they did something you didn't like. This is another trick question. You can see where this is going, right? I knew you could. So you're going to discuss a relatively minor example in which the interviewer is likely to empathize, feel your pain, and you're going to put a positive spin on your answer by describing what you learned from this difficult situation. In reality, the truth is you have to put a positive spin what you personally learned, about any of these questions, how you are going to become a more effective person, leader, student, worker. The next question they may ask is describe a leader you admire. Now, this I have going to be like warning. Feel free to give personal or popular examples of leaders you believe to be effective. However, you need to tread very carefully. You do not want to offend the interviewer, okay? And refrain from talking about your admiration, love for controversial people or controversial leaders. Frankly, you do not know their politics. You do not know their religion. You might even not know their race or their culture or their gender. You have no idea. So you need to be very careful. I would stay away from all political figures. Really? No, really. Who's left? Mom? No, you're not going to say mom is your favorite. And every year I say that, and every year somebody writes, my mom. No. Talk about why you admire a particular person. If you're going to college, try to choose somebody in your field. If you're going into medicine, choose a doctor. Not a talking head doctor, a doctor who has done something amazing in the particular field you want to go to, or an engineer. Don't pick the tried and true ones because that's just super cliche. And that's just a cliche, like you really didn't think about it. You're just like, Bill Gates. Yes, I love Bill Gates. Why? Because dude, he's rich. Yeah, see, no, that doesn't work. And more than just why you admire them. You're going to have to pick out particular traits of them. What lessons have you learned from them? How will you be able to incorporate their personality, their traits into your own professional or collegiate life? This is a tricky question. Now, stay away from religion as well, because once again, you do not know their religion. So if you love Jesus, that is great. If you're going to a Catholic university, just like a very cliche answer, choose then a great Catholic leader or martyr or somebody who's done great things for the Catholic Church. Same if you're going to some other kind of religious-based church. Don't choose your mom or your dad or your grandparents unless, there's one caveat, one exception to this, unless they did something amazing and stellar. Now, there's a lot of people who came from other countries and they did their own businesses, and that's great, but they're not necessarily a leader. So you need to find a leader, not mom or dad, unless they are truly, truly a leader in the, like, everybody knows them sense. The last part of this video is going to be about the most common interview complaints. And here they are. Interviewers say that the candidate lacked enthusiasm. The candidate did not ask any questions or did not ask the right questions. See videos 1 through 5. They were too fidgety. They didn't make enough eye contact. Their attire was too casual or simply inappropriate. They talked too much or not enough. Once again, you have to walk that fine line, find the sweet spot. It's a balancing act. Like all my metaphors there. Yeah. Okay, so your assignment for this is in the description box below, also on Google Classroom. You have a lot to do. This will take a while. Do it well. This is for you. If you answer these questions, if you are thoughtful in your responses, if you really think about this, then for your next interview, you will rock it. You will be prepared. And that was the whole point of this particular unit. Thanks so much. Bye-bye and stay smart.